My name is Maryam Al-Khawaja. I am 25 years old. I am the acting president of the Bahrain Center for Human Rights and the co-director of the Gulf Center for Human Rights. There were several reasons that made me decide to go back to Bahrain 2 weeks ago, approximately, a little more than that now. First of all, my two colleagues, Sayyid Yusuf and Nabil Rajab, were both in prison at the time. I needed to go back for coordinating our work on the ground, especially that the Bahrain Center for Human Rights is quite up there when it comes to being the target of harassment and imprisonment and targeting. So anyone who works with the center is usually targeted. And of course, to add to that, I wanted to see my family, whom I hadn't seen for almost 2 years, as well as my imprisoned father and my imprisoned uncle. Well, the initial crackdown in Bahrain, contrary to popular knowledge, didn't actually start in 2011. It started in 2010. On the 13th of August, 2010, there was a crackdown in which several well-known activists and political leaders in Bahrain were arrested. That was one of the first times we see that kind of crackdown since 2001. There had been other crackdowns after Hamad bin Isa had acclaimed himself king, and assumed power in the country. But when that happened, we knew things had changed, because for a very long time, since 2001, they had tended to play the good cop, bad cop scenario. And so the prime minister was always seen as the bad guy, and the king and the crown prince were seen as the good guys. And so what would normally happen is that the Minister of Interior, which was usually considered as being closer to the prime minister, would conduct arrests, beat people on the streets and so on, but then the king would come and pardon everyone and release them and so on. What happened in 2010 is that that scenario changed. They all became the bad cop. And we knew that something had changed within the policy of the royal family in Bahrain. Systematic torture had come back in Bahrain. And the cases that we were documenting at the Bahrain Center for Human Rights were cases of physical, psychological, and sexual torture. There were political trials going on fabricated charges. And so basically everything that we knew that was related to Bahrain in the 1990s was coming back. So I had to leave the country in the beginning of September 2010 because we received news that I might get arrested. And so I left the country and moved to London for a few months. Now, of course, when I heard that there might be a revolution and an uprising in Bahrain, I packed my bags and went back. I also knew that being that I had already, my name was becoming a little more well-known in Bahrain, and because of my father, the regime at that point was very, very sensitive about getting people angry because they were so afraid of the reaction of what would happen given what had already happened in Tunisia and Egypt. And so I knew I had a relative kind of safety in going back, that I wouldn't be arrested because they were trying to not rock the boat. And that's why I went back and was able to get in without any problems. And I stayed there for the beginning of the revolution, the beginning of the uprising. I was in Pearl Square, I was in the hospitals. I witnessed a lot of what happened. I was even there on the 17th of February when they attacked people while they were sleeping in the roundabout. And then in the beginning of March or the end of February, I received an invitation to go and testify at the Human Rights Council. And it was an invitation from the Cairo Institute for Human Rights Studies, who are good partners to the Bahrain Center for Human Rights. Personally, I didn't want to go. I wanted to stay and, stay as a part or stay as monitoring for the situation in Bahrain. My father took me aside and spoke to me, and he told me that every role within a movement is important. And one of the important roles is making sure that our case is known internationally. One of the things that have an influence in Bahrain is the international spectrum. And as human rights defenders and as human rights activists, we are able to relay the situation on the ground from a human rights perspective, which is not excusable and not justifiable for the regime. And so he basically convinced me into leaving and going to the Human Rights Council. Of course, when I left, I thought I was leaving for 2 weeks. And I packed a very, very small bag, and I left the country knowing that I'd be back. But a few weeks later, the GCC forces came into Bahrain, and I knew that the situation had changed and that I would not be able to go back anytime soon. On the night that my father was arrested, I was on a train between DC and Providence. I had just finished doing meetings in DC and I was going to Providence where I was staying with a friend. My phone had died and I didn't have a charger, so I actually took a nap, but I woke up with this very heavy feeling that there was something happening, and so I asked someone sitting next to me for a charger. And as soon as I switched on my phone, it started going off, and it was my friend who was in Providence. And as soon as I picked up, she said, "Maryam, I'm going to tell you something, but you don't panic." And I said, "Okay." And I already had this really heavy feeling that there was something completely wrong. And she said, "They just arrested your father and your two brothers-in-law." I didn't really have a reaction. I went completely numb. I could tell that I was crying, but I wasn't doing it on purpose. And what I did was I got off the phone and I went on Twitter and I started reading my sister Zainab's tweets about how the arrest had happened. And I don't think you can really describe those kind of emotions in such a situation, because it becomes surreal. When they took my father away, we didn't know if he was alive or dead. And it's one thing to be inside Bahrain. I mean, you can't really compare it, right? You can't compare whether it would have been worse to be there and watch my father being beaten unconscious and my two brothers-in-law getting arrested along with him. Or is it worse to be sitting all by yourself, millions of miles away, and receive news like that? I can't compare it because I haven't been in the other situation. But it is really difficult receiving that kind of news when you're all by yourself and there's no one around you that you can talk to or look to for support. I was very nervous to see my father and uncle, of course. I didn't know if the two people that I was going to meet in prison were the two people I had left behind when I left Bahrain 2 years ago. Both of them have been very severely tortured. When my uncle was arrested, he was thrown off the roof of the house he was in. His wife was sexually assaulted. His children, who are very, very young, had guns pointed at their heads. And so I knew that going back into Bahrain is not going to be the Bahrain that I had left behind. And that scared me to some extent because I didn't know what to expect. But I was very relieved when I met my uncle and my father. Physically, they've changed. You can see the markings on my father's face where his face was broken and fractured. And I could also tell that my uncle physically had been harmed. But spiritually, they haven't been able to touch them. And for me, that was such a great relief that despite breaking their bodies, they have not been able to break their spirits. My uncle was, you know, I didn't see my uncle for a very long time. It was about 5 minutes and he was taken away. But I got to spend about 2 hours with my father in the first visit and then another 2 hours with my father in the second visit. And, you know, granted, like I said, that he had changed a lot physically. He was a lot thinner. He had all these marks on his face and so on, but the way that he talked, the way that he joked around was the exact same person that I remembered from 2 years ago. Everything I do is influenced by my father. There are so many messages or lessons that he taught me that I didn't even realize I had learned until I started doing this work. For example, one of the lessons that he taught me was you always need to know who your audience are. And I didn't quite understand that message until, you know, I assumed the role that I have internationally. You can't try to influence the international scenario towards Bahrain unless you deliver the right messages to the right people. You know, when you're talking to people who are more defense-oriented, more security-oriented, they don't really care about human rights. So your argument has to be from a human rights perspective, but it has to tap into why human rights and observing human rights and having consequences towards violations is so important to the security situation. When you're talking to students, is not the same message that you deliver when you're talking to politicians or when you're talking to the UN Human Rights Council. And so that was one of the things that really had a huge influence in my job. Another thing that he taught me, which I think not only helped me in my work, but helped me to keep going, is don't hate people, but hate actions. When you hate actions, you have the right kind of reaction. Because when you make it more personal, when you make it about fighting people rather than actions, first of all, your moral ground is not as strong. You judge more based on who it is that you're fighting and who it is that you're supporting rather than you know, ideas and morals and principles. And one of the things that my father taught me was, when you're fighting someone who's a human rights violator, you fight them because of the violations. And when you're supporting people because they're being violated, or because they're demanding something that you also believe in, don't do it because they either serve a political agenda that you believe in, or because they, you know, have the right religious beliefs, or because they have the right backgrounds. It doesn't matter who they are. You support them because they're fighting for the right things. And then when they have different views on things that you don't agree with, then you don't agree with that. But when, even if you don't agree with them on many other grounds, if they come out and make the right call, then you stand with them in that right call. And you know, the best example for this was when the protest happened in Kuwait. The people who went out and protested against the change in law of the parliament in Kuwait were people who had supported, not all of them, of course, but some of them were people who had supported the entrance of the GCC forces in Bahrain. They were people who had strongly stood against the uprising in Bahrain. But I came out and publicly supported their movement, not because of who they are, and not because of their political aspirations or whether they supported the Bahraini revolution or not. That is not how I balance who I support and who I don't support. I supported them because the demands that they were making were demands that I agreed with on principle. And that's where it matters. I think for a lot of us, we understand the importance of getting international attention and even local attention to get our job done. But for a lot of us also, we don't really like that comes with it. You know, I remember growing up, my father didn't like the fame that came with his work. And so when he would go to protest, for example, he would wait until people would gather, and then he would sneak into the middle of the crowd, because he didn't like being recognized as being extraordinary, because he didn't believe that he was. And I think the same thing goes for me and my sister. We don't believe that what we're doing is extraordinary. It's normal. It's normal that you see injustice and you decide to do something about it. It's abnormal that you see injustice and don't do anything about it. And I think this is the message that we continuously try to relay. I think it's unfair that I get more media attention than other people. And I understand that to a large extent it's because of my work, it's because I have a good English accent, and it's because I have a Danish passport. But I also know that there are so many untold stories. There are so many people who suffer and don't get attention. And I don't think that I'm a good representative of what it is like to be Bahraini. For example, my recent trip to Bahrain. I got in and I got out without any problems. And I think to a large extent because the Bahraini government wanted to use that as a PR spin. To say, look, things are good in Bahrain. This girl who's been talking about being threatened for 2 years got in and out of the country without any problems whatsoever. But that is in no way representative of the situation on the ground or what other Bahrainis go through. It's because I have international attention. And because if I had gotten arrested or interrogated or in any way had gotten any kinds of problems, there would have been an international reaction. Whereas so many other people go unnoticed. And I think, you know, it hit me the hardest when I was interviewing a victim while I was in Bahrain. I spent most of my time there documenting violations. And I was sitting with someone who had been summoned and threatened with torture. He's a former torture victim. And he had been summoned for interrogation and was getting threatened with torture by the person interrogating him. And it had happened in the absence of a lawyer. And so, of course, for me, my first reaction was, why did you allow them to interrogate you without a lawyer? You know? And there was someone else who was sitting with us and who was also a former torture victim. And he started laughing. And he said, you think that everyone in Bahrain... Or he said, not everyone in Bahrain is Nabil Rajab or you are Zainab Al-Khawaja. For us, if we're sitting there in the interrogation room and we say we're not going to answer your questions unless we have a lawyer, their response is, lock the door, we know how to get answers out of you. Their reaction is not going to be like, oh, wait a minute, let me get you a lawyer. And for me, that really shook me, because although we understand the situation on the ground, I don't think we always fully understand it. We don't always fully understand the price that comes with not having the kind of international attention that we have. You know, we are a lot more bold when we go out. It's a lot easier for me to stand, or for Zainab, to stand in the face of security forces and refuse to move than it is for other people, because she knows that she will get attention internationally if she's arrested or beaten or whatever, and she still gets beaten. So imagine what happens to people who don't have that kind of attention.